So what I want to talk through today is integrating critical social science and physical science together, and how you actually make that happen. So coming from geography, which is very much framing my understanding of this, we have decades of calls for integrating the field. I mean, you can time it pretty regularly to about an 8 to 10 year cycle of the calls come out, and there's special issues, and you know everybody says, oh, we've got to do this, and then nothing happens. So what I want to talk briefly about is kind of intellectual and practical barriers, but I'm going to argue in this talk that this integration is both doable and is necessary. I'm going to make a rather strong claim that if we want to understand what's happening at our field sites, that we cannot do that without having some kind of integrated analysis. All right, so quick overview, so you have a sort of roadmap for the talk. Okay, I will be first touching briefly on these barriers that I've discussed, and actually I suspect many of you will have ideas about that as well from your experience. But the bulk of the talk is going to be walking you through a research project that was a collaboration amongst physical and social scientists looking at the marketization of stream restoration in the US, and I will unpack that and explain what I'm talking about when we get there. And then the last section is going to be talking through the implications for integrating research. So ordinarily, when you get to that like last final section of the talk, you can relax because there's like two more slides coming. Don't do that this time, please. It's going to be a bit longer. All right, here we go. So first, barriers to interdisciplinary research and why we bother to overcome them. I suspect these will look familiar to you. So there's lots of issues about mutual unintelligibility. Okay, there are epistemological claims. What do we think it's possible to say about the world in terms of truth? There are specific methodological issues because often we're not cross-trained. So I can say to a colleague among the physical geographers in my department, oh, I'm going to be doing snowball sampling. And she will have no more idea of what I'm saying than if I said to one of my social science colleagues, hey, I'm doing worm and pebble counts this weekend. Right? So there's this big problem, right, that we don't, it's very difficult to understand what each other do because we don't have the training. Right? There are also issues with key concepts, where in some cases the key concepts are just unfamiliar to each other, so they sound like jargon, right? Or in other cases we have the same word but mean something different. Yeah, so it can get a little confusing. There are different timelines for research. If I want to say anything meaningful about how a stream system is changing over time, I need multiple years, multiple field seasons, right, to talk about how it's going over a relatively long period of time. But in my social science training in political ecology, it's quite ordinary for someone to go to the field for a 12-month period or an 18-month period and be done with their field work, right? You don't need that time series. And so there can be conflicting time series, timelines for results. There can be different expectations about generalization. And there's also, I would love it if none of you had ever experienced this, but I've certainly seen a fair amount of disrespect across the divide. So, you know, one of the funniest emails I've ever gotten was this lovely email from a fisheries ecologist who just read my book, but it was forwarded, and I shouldn't have, but I looked down the chain, and after, you know, you got to the bottom of the thing, and it said, okay, I know social scientists are navel-gazing idiots, but this woman has something to say you really need to hear, right? And, you know, and then for the same thing, it was quite common in social science seminars, at least in my graduate program, to speak very dismissively about kind of the positivism of natural scientists, which you may or may not know is an insult to human geographers to say. So disrespect is a big deal, right? I don't see how we can collaborate with that. There are also issues, and here's something that you all don't have to deal with, but for many people there are institutional separation issues. You know, as a biologist once said to me, how would I find a social scientist and ask her to dance? Not in a like literal like, okay, let's dance sense, but in a like, how would I find someone that's open to collaboration? Right, how would this work? There are logistics. You know, I've been hearing from many people in the last few weeks as I talk with graduate students about the difficulty of getting interdisciplinary work funded, getting it through journals, when reviewers are often saying, you know, I was talking with someone who was saying, oh, you know, I got a review that said the dendrochronology aspect of my work was great, but you know, why was I talking about this cultural baloney? Right? So figuring out how to navigate that can be difficult. And there's also the question for more junior scholars of if you do this integrative work, how do you find a job, right? That can be a big barrier. In the US, I think that actually makes you a more appealing candidate, but I understand that in some European contexts or some UK contexts, that's just not the case. All right, so given all that, why would you bother? Always an important question. Okay. I want to argue that we can no longer explain what we're seeing if we study environmental questions, okay, unless we think about the ways in which what we're studying is shaped together by physical and social forces. That it's just simply not the case that we can go find pristine sites that have no human impacts, and that vice versa, that the human environmental issues we're studying have strong physical forces at play as well. So just basic explanatory power. If we want to understand what's going on, we have to do this kind of work. I would argue that when you are considering physical and social factors together, you have far more relevance as well, far more political access, because you're speaking to the broad range of forces at play. And then I would also argue that our work is already tangled in social relations. What gets funded, what we can work on, the concepts we use have histories to them. You know, so for example, I'm thinking about Nathan Sayer's fantastic work about the way in which the concept of carrying capacity comes out of, you know, racist, eugenicist, colonial policy, right? Most of us don't realize that. We use it and think, oh, well, it's a good neutral concept. Okay, but in fact, it carries these political implications with it. And if we don't think through the political implications of the terms we use, then we're saddled with other people's politics, which we may or may not agree with. Okay. So, that was the pitch for, in theory, why I think integrated research is worth it. And as I, you know, guessing by your presence here that this is an easy sell for me. But doing it in practice is always tough. Yeah, we can have very good intentions, but how do we make this work? So what I want to do is talk through a kind of project that I worked on, and I'll give you more detail on it first, but I want to give it a bit of intellectual framing to begin with. Okay? So the big ballpark I'm working in is market-based environmental management. And this is the idea, for example, of biodiversity offsetting, which I know has been quite debated in the UK. But let me just stop and take a minute right now and say, is this familiar to you all, the idea of like markets for ecosystem services, for example, or would it be helpful for me to kind of take a step back and explain? I'm seeing, yeah, okay, that's fine. All right. So you know, the basic idea here in Kathy McAfee's great mind is that we would sell nature in order to save it. Okay, so the argument being, okay, the way that we have done environmental protection in the past through kind of strict regulation has failed. We need a new approach. I'm not trying to say this is what I think. I'm trying to say this is the argument that's made in support of markets. Yeah? So the way then to protect nature from the encroachments of capitalism is to better integrate it into capitalism, okay, to get a price tag on it. So at this point, there are credit markets for things like water quality, for habitat, for carbon sequestration, though obviously that one didn't work so well. But there are markets, ecosystem service markets on every continent except Antarctica at this point. And it's quite common as something to be advocated in international environmental policy circles. The literature on this in geography is described as the neoliberal nature's literature. Neoliberalism being kind of very bluntly the argument that we're better off if we leave the organization of things to market principles rather than to government intervention. And in that literature, there are two dominant sets of claims about the idea of putting a price tag on nature in order to save it. Okay. So the first claim says, nature is intransigent, it's stubborn. We can commodify it, we can try to commodify it all we want, but it's not going to behave the way we want it to. So we don't really need to worry about this trend towards marketization. It's not going to do anything in the world because nature won't cooperate. Okay, so that's one set of arguments about it. The second set of arguments said, oh my goodness, look at what these moves towards privatization and commercialization have done to healthcare, to public education, right? The provision of public services more broadly. This has been terrible. If we're going to apply it to the environment, it must be awful. Okay? It's going to have to be. So I think of this as kind of a choice between complacency and panic. But to date, there's been no biophysical data to evaluate what these markets for ecosystem services actually do on the ground in a physical sense. Right? What are they making happen? So the motivation for this project, for me and my fellow researchers on this, was twofold. So it had a joint social and physical motivation, which I think is quite important. So from a social science perspective, the idea was to fill in a major gap in the neoliberal nature's literature, because we just didn't know how to think about it. And from a physical science perspective, it was, you know, what in heaven's name is happening at my field site for my collaborator that worked on streams in North Carolina. So the project, my two collaborators were first Martin Doyle, who's a fluvial geomorphologist at Duke University, and Morgan Robertson, who's a political ecologist at the University of Wisconsin. And what we were studying, the specific case I'm going to talk to you about, is called stream mitigation banking. Okay? And the basic idea here is that it's a market for the ecosystem services provided by streams. And I'm going to explain this in a little more detail as we go. So what I will just say right now is that the basic idea is trying to figure out how do you create an exchangeable commodity out of streams. A little weird. I'm about to say streams. We'll get to how they do it in a moment. What we were trying to investigate was, first of all, how this commodity for sale, what's called a stream credit, how it's defined. Okay, how do tensions among perspectives from state actors, scientific actors, and market actors get worked out in order to make this market function through this credit definition? So that's kind of piece one. And then the very much related piece is what's happening on the ground. Okay, is there a landscape signature of this marketization? Okay, if you were out for a hike in the US and you came across a stream that had been restored, could you do a relatively simple set of measurements and figure out whether this was a stream that had been restored for market purposes or with a more ecological idea in mind? So this is what we were trying to figure out. So the research methods that we used, okay, in terms of social science methods, we had done a nationwide survey to pick our field sites and chose to concentrate in three states that were at different stages in stream mitigation banking. Okay, most of the data I'm going to present to you today is from North Carolina. We did semi-structured interviews with people who designed these projects, with the for-profit companies that did them, that built them, with state regulators and scientists. We did a bunch of document work, we did analysis, we did participant observation. We did Q method, which is a way of quantitatively measuring subjective positions, and I'm happy to talk to you a bit about that in the question and answers if you want. I'm not going to be presenting any data from that today. And then on the geomorphic side, we did a bunch of data mining, and I'll explain how that worked in a minute, and we also did new field work. Okay. So the basic regulatory context for stream mitigation banking, what sets it up, is the U.S. Clean Water Act. Okay, and Section 404 of the U.S. Clean Water Act says that you may not harm, physically damage, a stream or wetland. Okay, so you're not allowed to do it, is the idea. Okay. But in practice, what happens, so we're supposed to go through something called the mitigation hierarchy, which you may or may not be familiar with, but the idea is that a project should be designed to avoid impact, if at all possible. If you can't avoid, then you should design to minimize these impacts. And it's only after the impacts have been avoided and minimized as much as possible that you're allowed to compensate for them. And this is the idea of mitigation, hence the mitigation in that title. Okay. So the thing is that neither of the lead agencies who are in charge of implementing the Clean Water Act, which is the Environmental Protection Agency and the US Army Corps of Engineers, neither of them have been willing to take the heat for refusing permits. Okay, so the EPA, well, the Corps in any given year tends to reject about a quarter of a percent of the applications it gets. And EPA in its history has rejected, I believe, 19 permits. Okay, so what that means is that there really isn't strong enforcement of this do no harm idea. Instead, what happens is that we tend to skip, in the US, we tend to skip. We don't even do the avoid and minimize stage. Okay, we tend to go right to compensatory mitigation. So projects come in, they're already at 60% design level. I don't know if there are any designers in the room, but that means that a great deal of money has been put into them together already before they can even go to their permit hearing. Okay, and at that point, it's just too politically and economically expensive for agencies to say, stop, go back and redesign. Okay, so I think of it as a bit like a system of Catholic indulgences. Yeah, if that's familiar to you. Okay, so what happens is that then instead of redesigning projects, a project advocate is required to purchase credits to make up, to compensate, or to offset the harm of the project they proposed. Okay. And that's what these stream credits are, and that's what the stream mitigation banking market is supposed to do. Okay. So what we have then is a commodity market, but not for tons of wheat or ounces of gold or, you know, giant containers of orange juice. It's a commodity market for streams, okay, which is a big shift and how resources have been commodified. I'm going to talk a bit about how you do that in a moment, but first I want to give you a little bit more of a sense of how stream mitigation banking works. Okay, so stream mitigation banks are typically small for-profit companies, say 6 to 11 employees approximately, with a regional scope but not a national scope. There are a few that are that big, but most of them tend to specialize in one U.S. state or in a few. Okay. And the way that they work is they speculatively acquire property rights. So they don't necessarily buy them, but they often do something called buying a conservation easement, which I'm not sure there's an equivalent for in Europe, so I'm not sure how familiar that would be to you. But it's basically the rights to use the piece of property, whereas the person who owned it before still owns the underlying land. Yeah. So they speculatively acquire land with a degraded stream on it, and then they pay someone to develop plans to restore that stream, and to develop a monitoring plan to make sure that the stream stays in good health over a period of time. Then they restore, once that stream is restored, they are given and certified by federal agencies, they are given stream credits to sell, and then those credits are available to any Clean Water Act permit applicant to offset the damage from their project. So imagine for a moment you are proposing a new housing development. There's an inconveniently located stream that goes right through the middle of the property that you need to put into a pipe underground and effectively ecologically destroy in order to do your project. You walk in, you present your plans, they say, wish you'd done it differently, but all right. You need to go purchase this amount of credits to offset the damage that you're gonna do. You walk out of the meeting, you do something effectively like waving your checkbook in the air to find the people who have produced the relevant kind of credits. You negotiate a price with them, you buy the credits, and your obligation under the Clean Water Act is done. Okay, you're clear, you're good to go. Questions about that so far? That was a pretty fast overview. Okay.
All right, sorry, can I just ask, what scale is that on? Is that, so you could, the work could be done, you know, in one side of the US and you could be then buying the credits on the other side, or is it limited within a certain, you can only buy credits within a certain geographical?
It's a great question. Okay, so what there are, it's called service areas that are determined for a bank, for a mitigation bank, when that bank is set up. And it depends where in the US you are, how big that will be. It will certainly be within the same Army Corps district, which doesn't quite correspond to state boundaries because it's set by watershed boundaries, but it's fairly close, yeah. Are you familiar with HUCS, the way USGS defines watershed size?
No.
Okay. So in some cases, it can be very, very large, on the order of half of a U.S. state, and in some cases where there's a quite strong market demand, it can be smaller. But it's a balancing act that regulators do between what is ecologically, even remotely reasonable, and what will allow the market to function.
Yeah.
Okay. Is that?
Thanks.
Yeah.
And it's in the same watershed, then.
Yes, but you know, watershed is scale neutral, right? So it could, it's not as bad as, oh, it's in the Mississippi Basin, right? It doesn't get that bad. But it would certainly be much bigger than say, oh, here's a 100 kilometer watershed that we think it's reasonable for you to be in. It's gonna be on at least an order of magnitude larger than that. Actually, I think many orders of magnitude larger than that. Yeah, okay, good, okay. So at this point in the United States, more than 75% of the mitigation banks are entrepreneurial, for-profit, okay, which I think is actually quite different from, there's something like this now in Germany already, and you have some of this in the UK too, in little pockets. But it's often provided by the state itself, not by private companies. This is a bit different. The clients for this, there's a kind of a range of clients. The biggest client, though, is state highway departments. So think for a minute about how roads cut across the countryside. Yeah, they're going to intersect a lot of streams along the way. Okay, so that's the biggest client, but there's also local sewer districts, local airports, for example, and then the huge market from private developers. Okay, so at this point, as far as we know, no one has been able to figure out exactly how big this market is economically, but we know that from just the state departments of transportation, because we have access to that, it's in the billions of dollars per year. So now back to this question of how in heaven's name do you make a commodity out of something as complex, as particular, and as interconnected as a stream. Right? So the idea is that you have to figure out, you can't use the normal ways that we define commodities. Okay? We define them by weight, by volume, by number, which in relation to streams clearly made no sense. Okay, so you have to figure out how are you going to pare away the ecological specificity and connectedness of a stream so that you can establish it as a tradable commodity. So it's a task of equivalence of saying, okay, this segment of stream, it's not going to say that it's equivalent to any other segment of stream. Okay, you can't take a stream that's, you know, an ephemeral, like this big thing, water it occasionally, and say, oh, it equates to the Mississippi River. Okay, but what are the things that you can equate it to? How do you establish the equivalence? And think about the way we deal with commodities. Okay, it has to be a standardized, repeatable equivalence. You know, so I'm seeing head nods, but just to kind of give one more example of this, just to make sure we're on the same page. Let's say you go to the grocery store and you buy the same carton with the same packaging. Most of the time it's milk, but sometimes it's orange juice. Right? You may stop buying that brand and go to a different brand of milk where you can be sure that it's still milk every time, right? We expect our commodities to be stable. That's how markets function. So how do you do that with streams? For wetlands mitigation, which is the other part of what gets covered under the Clean Water Act, okay, it's academics and it's scientists at agencies that have developed those classifications. And they're different, there are dozens of them, perhaps even hundreds of them, that have been used at various times across the US. But it's been very much a task of people that folks in this room would recognize as scientists and acknowledge as their peers.
Yeah.
In streams, there was a widely used metric in place already that was developed by a private sector consultant named Dave Rosgen. Okay, and you need to know a little bit about that classification in order to understand what's coming, so I'm going to say just a bit about it. Okay, so the first thing to know about it is that it is based on physical measurements of channel form. Okay? And the idea is that that serves as a good proxy for the other things that we care about in restoration as well, which in the US is water chemistry and critters, you know, biology, the biology of the stream.
Yeah?
So the idea is that if you restore the channel, the other things we want, the physical form of the channel, the other things we want will naturally come. Okay, and in the US, this is referred to by critics of this as the field of dreams approach. Now, I don't know if you had the bad luck of seeing that really terrible movie. Very briefly, it's a movie about a farmer in Iowa who has this vision that if he builds a baseball park in his cornfield, that the ghosts of the disgraced White Sox baseball team of, I think it's 1917 or 1918, who threw the World Series, they took bribes to lose it. Yeah, okay, so they're called the Black Sox. Those ghosts of those disgraced baseball players will come back and play and redeem themselves. And so the thing that this farmer hears about the movie is build it and they will come, okay? And so that's the critique that critics use of this. This is the field of dream thing. I'm not telling you this just for whatever, it will come back in the talk. Yeah, okay. So the second thing that you need to know about this classification system is that it includes careful work to make sure that the way you classify streams is scale neutral. Okay, so you're always putting, you know, measuring back or dividing back through by dimensions to get dimensionless ratios for everything you can. So this classification system, which is alphanumeric, so every classification is like an A2 or a B4. Okay, the idea is that a B4 stream could be this big, or it could be, you know, almost as wide as this room. But it has these shared characteristics, so it gets the same label. But you shouldn't know, you shouldn't be able to hear the classification and know what scale you're looking at. All right. So, the thing is that by the time the stream mitigation market in the US got going in 2000, Rosgen's classification system was almost ubiquitous in the stream restoration community in the US. Even if people didn't agree with it, they could use it because their clients were requiring them to. Okay, so given that there was this classification system in place already, when stream credits were being defined, their initial definition was by linear foot of a particular Rosgen channel type. And that's how they set up this repeatability standardized equivalence. All right. Now, this sets up two really important perverse incentives. So the first one, because it's scale neutral, okay, think for a minute. Do you think it's going to be more expensive to restore a stream that's as wide as this room or a stream that's this wide? To manipulate the physical form. Yeah, the big one, right? OK, Okay, so it sets up an incentive to damage big and restore small. Okay, the second thing is the credits were by linear foot. And the hardest part of the job for mitigation bankers is finding a property with an obviously degraded stream that the owner is willing to sell them rights to. Okay, so that's the biggest cost for them, is finding and acquiring property. So the incentive, given that it's by linear foot, is to create the most sinuous possible stream you possibly can on the property you have. All right, so this was the situation when we started our field work in 2006. It was a long project for me to say, which is something I'll address at the end. And regulators were saying, look, is this mitigation making actually producing ecological lift, which is the technical term in the Clean Water Act for restoring health? Okay. So we're saying, what are we actually doing? The whole premise of build it and they will come, you know? Is it accurate? You know, is this making a difference? But nobody knew. Okay. So that's basically the driving force of this project. So, the data I'm about to present is entirely from North Carolina, which is a hotspot of stream restoration and of mitigation banking in the US. Okay? And it's mined from two places, okay? Or it's mined from one place. The monitoring data, so I mentioned very briefly, and please don't worry if this went by too fast, I mentioned briefly that stream mitigation projects have to be monitored for a period of time before all of the credits from the project are released. In North Carolina, that's 7 years now. Okay? And what it's monitored for is stability. Since the restoration process is focused on creating this particular Rosgen channel type, which is about particular physical form of the channel, what's monitored is that physical form to make sure that it's stable. Okay? So we have geomorphic monitoring yearly, in many cases, for a very, very large group of projects. So that was one thing we looked at. Okay? And let me just be clear that So I'm not trying to say that we were looking just at the design plans or just at the as-built, that is how it was implemented. What we were looking at was change over time. Yeah? Okay. And then we also decided that we wanted to be able to compare that to streams that had been restored under other kind of funding sources, particularly funding from the Environmental Protection Agency, so they were concerned with ecological issues. And then what was happening with unrestored streams? Okay, streams that were in North Carolina that nobody had bothered to try to fix yet. Okay, I want to be quite clear that these unrestored streams are not in any sense pristine. I think that's probably an easy message to sell in the UK. It's harder in the US. But what we would argue that pretty much any stream in North Carolina has been impacted by human influences in some way, right? So this is not trying to say, oh, here's this pristine, beautiful, natural thing. I'm not saying that. Okay, good. All right, so the N on this is 186, which sounds small for those of you that do big data, but is actually quite a large number. It's, we believe, one of the biggest data sets in the physical form of restored streams in the US. So I need to say just a little bit more before I start showing you data. So the first thing is that for those of you who have not been in North Carolina or in the Carolinas and the US in general, it has three very, very different physiogeographic provinces. Okay, I've heard people describe it as a laboratory with three beakers. Okay, there's the mountains, which are the Appalachians, which are quite steep and eroding. Okay, there's the Piedmont, which is the depositional plain, which is kind of less sloped, but still, you know, fairly. And with lots of kind of, well, it's not so important, but just that it's not mountains. It's not like this. And then there's the coastal plain, which is so flat that this is part of the area of the US where we're expected to see coastlines move inland by 5 miles over the next, say, 70 to 80 years. Okay, it's really, in US terms, as flat as a pancake, for real. Okay, so that has, for those of you that do anything with physics of streams, that will have obvious implications to you. Don't worry about it if it doesn't. But if you see those categories in the graphs, that's what we're talking about. The second way the data is divided, and this will be the most visible because it's color, done by color, is into streams that were restored for profit through mitigation banking, streams that were restored for ecological purposes through other funding sources, and streams that haven't been restored. Okay, and again, not pristine, reference, whatever, just whatever happened to be there. Okay, so the question was, could we distinguish mitigation from non-mitigation stream restoration? Going back a step, is there a clear physical signature of the marketization of the environment, or not? All right, so our hypotheses, and these are really notable to me because we were so utterly and completely wrong. Okay. So our hypotheses were first that we would see the increased sinuosity I talked about, and that secondly, because of the perversion sensitive to damage big and restore small, that we would see mitigation banking disproportionately on headwater streams. So the sources of streams where they're quite tiny. Yeah? Alright. So we expect to find lots of blown out mitigation projects because this is not a form that will hold, at least not except on the coastal plain. So maybe some version of panic and complacency in terms of thinking about the impacts of marketizing streams. Okay. So in all of the graphics that I'm going to show you today, the green is streams that have not been restored. The orange is streams that have been restored for profit, and the blue are streams that have been restored for ecological purposes. All right, so first thing to think about, drainage basin size. These numbers are scarily close, actually. So quite far from, scarily is the wrong word, but just kind of notably close. So quite far from our hypothesis that this, you know, should have been way up here. In fact, the percentage of mitigation projects that are on quite small streams is quite proportional to the percentage of those small streams on the North Carolina landscape as a whole. Okay? So there are some differences. This one is particularly striking, that the streams restored for ecological purposes are way disproportionately on larger streams. And if that's something you want to hear more about, I'd be happy to discuss that in questions. All right, but basically, our hypothesis here, that this line should have been way out of line with this one, totally wrong. All right, but maybe the sinuosity, maybe that would be okay. Not so much. Box whisker charts. Y'all know how to read these, or would an explanation be helpful? Can't tell from your faces. Explanation, yes, good. This is a way of visualizing, just quickly, the spread of data. Okay. So the idea is that this box here goes from the 25th percentile to the 75th percentile. The line in the middle is the median. The lines that come out show you the range. Okay, so this will be the 0 and this the 100 result, yeah? So this is just a very fast way of being able to see the spread on data. Okay, so note that this scale here, there's not a lot of difference. You know, it's quite a small scale. So what we found was that indeed the sinuosity of streams restored for profit is a bit higher than the streams restored not for profit, and for the streams that are unrestored in particular. But for geomorphologists, a sinuosity of less than 1.2 is actually quite low. I mean, it seems, you know, from talking it through, it seems likely to reflect kind of artificial straightening by people rather than a natural condition. So in fact, when Martin Doyle, our geomorphologist, was looking at this, he was sort of happier about those. Okay, they seemed like they were probably healthier than the unrestored streams. So, but we certainly didn't see, you know, if you were gonna get a shape like this, right, you'd have a sinuosity that's off this chart. Clearly not happening. So, wrong, 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 wrong. We were wrong. So then we go back to our interview subjects to say, all right, what is happening here? Can you help us understand why these very clear economic incentives aren't being taken up? Okay, and they were quite clear about it. So the first thing was that they absolutely insisted that they use the same design approach for stream restoration, regardless of the funding source. So North Carolina is a state in which everyone uses Rosgen's classification system, but also his channel design approach, which is called natural channel design. The designers use it, the regulators use it, the funders use it. It is the way you do stream restoration, right? Since there was total agreement on this, if the consultants had somehow decided to do something different than following Rosgen's rules when they were doing things for profit, it would have been an immediate red flag for the regulators. Yeah, it would have been very, very obvious that they were doing what mitigation people call chasing credits, which basically means trying to expand the economic benefits of the project at the expense of the kind of ecological concerns. So that was one big piece. Okay, and to be clear, and actually let me just say one more thing. Everybody who works on streams in the US, I've been working in this community since 2003, okay? With one exception, everyone I have interviewed in relation to stream restoration in the US cares deeply about the health of streams. Okay, they may be in it for profit, they may be scientists working on it, they may be designers working on it, they may be regulators, But there's a, you should assume goodwill here and care for the environment. Okay. And so that's part of it too, right? They think that the natural channels line approach is best, so of course they're gonna use it. All right, so that's one piece. But then when I looked all pathetic, thinking, oh my goodness, this research project that we've been trying to get going for years has just collapsed and burned in like the first 2 minutes, they said, okay, we think you'll find a difference in the project length, okay? That it's so expensive and difficult to acquire property, okay, that what you should, that mitigation projects will be longer, okay, through economies of scale for the bankers. And they said that. All right, so we thought, okay, we'll go back and look. So we did. And lo and behold, there's actually quite a large difference. Okay, projects that are where streams are restored for profit, the blue, are notably longer. Okay. But what was really surprising to us was why. And you know, my arm does not make a great drainage network, but we're just gonna work with it. All right, so the idea being, look, on any stream you have a kind of main trunk, a main stem, okay? And then you have tributaries that come in, yeah? So what we were finding was that they were restoring not just the main stem, but many, many, many tributaries coming in. And I will show you what this looks like, because I think it's easier to visualize from above. So this is a view from above. This is, imagine looking down on a stream. Okay, and this is a stream that was restored for ecological purposes rather than for profit, okay? All that they worked on, the only thing they worked on was the tributary. Okay, if you have any experiences reading topographic maps, you can see multiple places that tributaries, at least ephemeral ones, are coming in here, and they're not touching them, okay? By contrast, here's an aerial view of a project that was restored by a mitigation banker. So here's the main stem coming through here, and they're trying to restore everything they can coming in. So it's a way to maximize profit off a piece of property, but not by doing this. You see, you following? Okay, good. So as we were looking at that, we noticed something else that surprised us. All right. What we noticed was a really odd homogenization in the radius of curvature. So radius of curvature, for those of you that don't work on streams, as you may have noticed, most streams don't run in a straight line. Yeah, they have curves. So, and then the idea is, if you imagine taking, this is probably too old school, a protractor? Something that may, a protractor to try to measure how, kind of what the curve is on that actual curve. That's the idea of the radius of curvature. Okay, and on a normal stream, or a stream that hasn't been normal is a bad word, which I would get, an unrestored stream, there's an enormous range, and please be attentive to the fact that this is a logarithmic scale. Yeah, so it's going up by orders of magnitude. Okay, there's an enormous range in what you get. All right, and for the restored streams, didn't matter why they're restored, it's a much narrower range. So for those of you that this has been a little bit kind of unvisualizable, they look like that. Symmetrical sine curves, sine waves, yeah? By contrast, and these now are line drawings, yeah? So this is what one of those looks like in a drawing. This is what two segments that we just picked randomly of our unrestored streams look like. Okay, there are little curves, there are big curves, there are sharp curves, there are gradual curves, lots and lots of variety. All right, so then the question was why? All right, so we went back for a second round of interviews in 2015, this all has taken some time, yeah, all going through, to say, hey, what's going on? Basically, we did the social science equivalent of ground truthing. Okay, we took our findings, we went back and we sat down with everyone we talked to the first time again and said, hey, what's going on here? Does this surprise you? Why or why not? Like, what's going on? Okay, so what we heard was a couple of things. So first of all, this is not about Rosgen's natural channel design approach. Okay, that's not where that comes from. The specified way of designing radius of curvature in Rosgen influence projects is to find what's called a reference reach, which is as close to a pristine stream as you can get, to measure the range of radii of curvature there, and to try to put a similar range in your own project. So if you were following Rosgen's approach, you should have a wide range. of radius of curvature in your project, and yet nobody did. So what was going on? Well, so first, has anybody in here ever used AutoCAD software or any design software? Yeah, some yeses, some noes. The key thing to realize is that it was initially designed to allow engineers to design, lay out roads and buildings. Okay, so regular curves. Think back for a minute about this as a road. Okay, that would be a relatively curvy road to drive, but it would be fairly smooth. Now imagine you're trying to drive this. Okay, you better be paying attention or you're going off the side here. So engineers' software actually makes it very, very difficult to design irregular curves. So that was one piece. The second piece, and this is not me being rude about engineers, this is engineers saying themselves, they're like, we just think it looks better when it's symmetrical. It's prettier, and our shear stress equations work better. Okay, so that was a piece for it. They knew better, but they were doing it anyway. Last thing to point to, and this one is a bit complicated to explain. The way the property rights work for these streams is that they go a certain distance out from the farthest end of meanders. Okay, so you can see the buffer here coming out a set distance from each curve. Okay, now imagine that the curves are wildly irregular. Okay, and so you need a huge amount of property here and a small amount of property here. If you're trying to lay out fence lines, that gets expensive. If you're trying to survey it, it's just much easier on the property front if everything is straight and even. All right, so that's some part of it. But what seemed to be particularly important had to do with the economics of mitigation banking, which is that these projects are assumed to be stable. They're required to be stable. So over this 7-year monitoring term for these projects, if the channel moves laterally, that is if it erodes across the surface, or if it downcuts, they lose money, they lose credit. Okay, now they can go back in and repair the channel to bring it back to where it was when it was built. Okay, but for that they need a new construction permit, which is quite expensive. They need to get the equipment back out to do it, right? So it's very, very much in their economic interest for the channel to stay where it's put. Sharper curves are more likely to shift, to get cut off. Okay, so then what you end up with is strong, strong incentives for these very regular, gradual curves, right? They're not as likely to move. It's way easier to stabilize them. Okay. So then, going back to my original question, what is the landscape signature of this shift from kind of a regulatory emphasis to a market emphasis in environmental management of streams? We see a couple of big things. So, little increase in sinuosity, but longer project lengths, and those longer project lengths are achieved through restoring not just the main stem, but also the tributaries. Now, anybody with ecology training in the room? Theoretically speaking, if you believe that stream restoration works, which I realize many people don't, I would be with you, but if you believe that stream restoration worked, is this better or worse to do longer lengths and move out into the more into the catchment basin?
It's all terrible.
Okay, but if you believe restoration was good, it should be better, right? Because the idea is that you're being able to reach farther out of the watershed to address, for example, fertilizer or other things as it comes in, so that you can start to address things more broadly. So, given that for human geographers, the idea that neoliberalization or marketization of streams should be horrible, this was not exactly the finding people were hoping it would produce. But, okay, so in theory this should be better, but, and then here's the big one. Okay. Most striking was this homogenization of channel form with any kind of restoration under the Clean Water Act. Okay. Now again, I'm sorry to ask, but ecologically speaking, is it better to have more variety in channel form or worse?
Better.
Better, yeah? It should be, right? Because life, many, many organisms need different kinds of habitat at different life stages, yeah? So this is scary, right? But this is not specific to the marketization. Yeah? Okay, implications. As I said, don't go to sleep yet. There's a few more slides to go. Okay, So, what is market-based environmental management doing to streams? We would argue, based on our data from North Carolina, that it's doing very little that wasn't already happening to them before the emphasis on marketization was put in place. Okay, so we are continuing to allow the development, despite the fact that the Clean Water Act says no harm, do no harm. And the trends towards homogenization of stream form, in other words, that we see in projects that are done not for market reasons, are continuing and moving forward. More broadly. Okay, but what we don't see is an enormously clear, I mean, we have the length as the kind of clearest signature of this move towards marketization. Okay, but that has ambiguous consequences depending on what you think about stream restriction. All right, now here. So, what then would I say about this integrated kind of critical social and physical science approach? I hope, and this is what, as John mentioned in his introduction, this is what we refer to as critical geography. I hope that this is useful as a way of thinking about things beyond geography. So I would argue that it would have been impossible for us to understand what was happening with streams in North Carolina if we couldn't both have been looking at what was happening on the landscape and talking to the people that were making those transformations, right? That we needed both. Right. The question then, that's why. I had two versions of that slide in, my bad. All right, so what made it work? Why was this possible? Okay, I would argue because it's maybe you all have just solved this, and this talk is not useful to you because you're all already doing completely integrated work already. I'm gonna guess from the expressions on your faces right now that this is, it's a work in progress, right? I think for everybody, it's a work in progress. So why did this project work? Okay, because you know, the very first time I was presenting about this project was in Sweden in maybe 2010. And they had me go last. And everybody presenting on this what had been supposed to be this big grant, the Restore project, okay, that was this big grant to do integrated physical and social studies of stream restoration in Sweden. This was the big wrap-up. And every presentation before me said, oh, it was just too hard to do integrated work, it's not possible. So I did this and that person did that. And then I was in the very uncomfortable position of being saying, but you can! And then he was like, So why did it work? A couple of things to point to that I think are quite important. So the first one was that all of us have cross-training. Okay, I am never gonna call myself a fluvial geomorphologist. I think that would be quite insulting to people who do can own that name. But I've taken a lot of coursework in fluvial geomorphology and hydrology, enough that I could work with Martin Doyle on understanding and analyzing his data. Yeah? Martin is more self-taught along this front, but he's had quite a lot, particularly of history classes over the years. He writes history, he thinks, he's comfortable with social science methodologies, such that he could join me on interviews, and we could kind of think through this together, right? So we could, that I feel was very important in having some familiarity with methods and analysis techniques. Yeah? Second thing was, we wrote the first grant proposal for this project in 2006, but we didn't get it until 2009. And the reason was that we had to keep resubmitting. We got, the first time we got reviewers who were all ecologists who pointed out very noticeably that there was no ecology in the proposal at all. Very true. Second round, we got all political scientists who, for whatever reason, said it wasn't policy relevant, which baffled us since it was about policy, but you know, reviewers, you never know. Third time, we finally got people who were like, interdisciplinary, go! Okay, so the point is that we had to rewrite this grant three times. Okay, not ideal, but what it meant was that we really figured out a shared language. Okay, by the time we got that grant, we were ready to go. Because we had done some conceptual work to really understand how the others thought and talked. Okay, and it was interesting to us that there were some concepts that we needed to define that we had the same name for, but you know, neoliberalism isn't tossed around a lot in geomorphic circles, right? So we needed to kind of educate Martin about that and vice versa with some other things. But then we also discovered that there were some concepts that both fields had, but that we called different things. So kind of working through that shared language was big. As I sort of said already, but just to make very clear, we participated in each other's data analysis, and to some extent in collection. Okay, I think that's really good because then you understand the strengths and weaknesses of these methods, right? But we made quite substantive adjustments in the data we were collecting and how we analyzed it in response to each other's work. Yeah, so we learned from each other, which was really important. Goodwill, huge, yeah? Persistence as to these things. But here's the thing that I think is the most important part. And you know, if I have any useful suggestions of any kind, I think that this is probably it. Okay, which is that our research question, we couldn't answer it independently. Okay, if we did not work together, we couldn't get to the explanation we wanted. Okay, and so I would argue that as we're all struggling to kind of make more integrative work happen, that this question of a shared question that we care about deeply is really, really important. All right, so where is this critical physical geography, this field we're trying to get started going from here? Well, we've been doing, you know, there's been lots of interest in it. We've been doing lots of talks and special arts issues and conference sessions and such. Jahi just said, we're just back from the first European critical physical geography workshop. We have a handbook coming. We're really working on it. It feels like at this moment there's some momentum, thanks to things like the whole Anthropocene paradigm, between really trying to work on this so that geography is moving away from just saying, oh, we need to do it, to actually try. All right. So many, many thanks for your time and following folks. Really appreciate it, and I will very happily take any questions.